Good morning all, and thank you for joining us for the webinar on Game and Gamification Learning Imperatives in partnership with Change Inc. I am Shweta from People Matters, and before speaking about today's agenda, let me give you a brief about today's topic. Game-based learning serves both the employer and employee by improving productivity and positively impacting business. Gamification helps employees to learn and accomplish more skills, which rises competency levels throughout an organization. Gaming is also applied to boost knowledge and loyalty amongst customers, channel partners, and other stakeholders. In this webinar, we will discuss taking learning to the next level with adding game-based elements to learning initiatives, the scenarios that gamification and game-based learnings apply to, the elements that make gamification possible, case studies from our experience. Let me now introduce you to the speakers for the webinar. I am delighted to introduce Tamal Bhatia, founder of Change Inc. Tamal has a management degree from NMIMS Mumbai with over 17 years of experience in the human capital sector. He has worked with the leadership teams of organizations ranging from telecom to manufacturing. He is the founder of 4Degree Consulting, the parent company of Change Inc. A firm believer in the experiential learning process, Tamal has successfully designed and developed indigenous games, activities, and compete simulation games like Starship 2320 that address the behavioral aspects of leadership. He also holds the patent for the change measurement tech tools that are core to Change Inc.'s offerings. We also have with us Renu Kotian, Head of Product Content and Facilitation, Change Inc. Renu heads Change Inc.'s product portfolio. The flagship product, Sandbox, is creating game context for over 25 organizations today. A graduate from Wollongong University in Australia with a gold medal in MBA HR, with more than a decade of experience, Renu brings a truly altruist belief to development that is refreshing to the participants, and her ability to connect with her audience is something that she excels at. Her endeavors have taken her diverse places from the Everest Base Camp to boardrooms, where she spends time and energy in improving learning products for the next generation. Our partner for today's webinar is Change Inc. Change Inc. is a brand of 4Degree Consulting Private Limited. Change Inc. is an organization that enables and measures change. At the core of Change Inc.'s offering are technology and content platforms that enable organizations to create scalable outcomes in content or measurement. Change Inc. have been a part of the learning industry last 17 years and have delivered over 10,000 hours of training across wide cross-sections of clients such as Qualcomm, Cognizant, Wipro, Novartis, Cient, and many others. We have saved time for you to ask the questions at the end of the webinar. For those attending the live webinar, you can submit questions anytime during the presentation through the Q&A tab. We will try to respond to as many questions as time allows. I am super excited to hear what our speakers have in store for us today. So, without any further delay, let the experts take over now. Tamal and Renu, over to you.
Thank you, Shweta, and a very good morning to all of you. Welcome to our webinar on game and gamification imperatives, right? And primarily, when we look at game and gamification, we have a multitude of contexts or a multitude of things that come into our mind. The objective of this webinar is going to be to share our experience and what we see as where game is applicable and where gamification is applicable, and perhaps where both are applicable. So very quickly, we've been in the space for about two decades, significant expertise in experiential learning. We have a few patented change measuring platforms, and we have a dedicated team towards content, simulations, technology programs in skills and competencies. So at a very layman level, when we look at what does gamification really mean, it's almost like everybody wishes to play a game, but it does depend on your level of skill. So if you want to be a tennis player, you need to invest a significant amount of time in learning how to play. Versus essentially gamification really is about saying, what are the interesting parts of games that can be brought to a non-game context? So the primary requirement for a gamification context is that the skill elements are relatively low. So if you think about why somebody plays a video game, somebody plays a really invests in a video game because there isn't any significant skill involved. It's a skill that is easily translatable. You practice it for a bit and you have the skill to play. Right? So essentially allowing people to display control behaviors. So it is engaging enough that people want to display the desired behaviors and you constantly reinforce and reward relevant behaviors. Now, if we look at any gamification or any game-based engine, everybody needs to have some layer of competition. If you have no layer of competition, then the entire fundamentals of game mechanics die. We are unable to keep people engaged in the game. I need to know whether I am better than somebody by a factor of 5 or a factor of 10. Am I in the top 10%? Am I in the bottom 10%? Where can I go from here? So friendly competition is something that is important. There needs to be a sense of achievement. Clearly, at whatever level I am playing or I'm participating in a game, gamification provides for achievement. Fastest person to finish the quiz. You are the first person to finish the curriculum. You're the first person to finish the course. Amongst everybody who has finished the course, you rank in the top 5 percentile. In whatever way, we need to look at how we are providing for achievement. And to be at a baseline social, because without social, gamification is very difficult today, for open and honest conversations, which could include, you know what, there is this part that I am challenged with, or could I reach out to somebody and seek help with what they are able to do. And most importantly, where we find the game engines typically not able to translate into something that is meaningful, is the ability to create the work-related context in the game scenario. So there has to be an ability to say, where is the work-related context coming in, be it in the game, be it in the outcomes that the gamification needs to meet. That work-related context needs to be seamless in the design of your game or the gamification mechanism, right?
Absolutely. So I, you know, the powers that be and technology here, you know, what are you going to do? So yes, absolutely. I'll just take over from what Tamal was talking about, which is what gamification really means. And essentially, it is game mechanics used in a non-game context. And all the points that he mentioned before really are what the space of gamification could truly provide. Now, what I wanted to talk about right now is that games require purpose. If there is no purpose, then it's just playing games for game's sake. Intention is imperative when it comes to gamification, and that's really what the starting point of any gamification exercise should be. Some examples of what a gamification intent could look could be, for example, is engaging people in company values. It could be, especially if there is a new value system that's being incorporated or something that needs to be refreshed for a particular vision direction, this is something that could be the intent of a game board. Developing a specific competency with a group of people, and we will actually be taking you through a case study that that we've actually been through with one of our clients for exactly this purpose. One other would be the more simpler creating grounds for team bonding, and what we, in our experience, we've seen that gamification truly does take this particular intention to the next level beyond, you know, the typical offsites, etc. Introducing a new challenge to the organization, especially when it comes to mentorship, even coaching exercises, it doesn't really have to go through just being about competency development. It could very much also be, you know, if it's a new direction, if there are people getting into a new leadership role, these are fantastic spaces to actually use gamification as an intention. And of course, there is the activating passion for work. A lot of us know this as employee engagement, but of course, that we all know that means a lot of things. But it's again a great space for where gamification can actually add value. So just a quick sideline to the People Matters folks. I think Tamal is back online. I will continue until perhaps we could get him to be the presenter. All right. Tamal, over to you.
Thank you. So when we look at the purpose of building a game, building a game board, and building gamification, we could literally move in any direction, and anything can be gamified. So just to give you a very quick example of what we are sort of doing in this space, there are different challenges that as the organizations grow and as the organizations try to imbibe a larger and a faster learning curve for their people, how do we get people to consume the content? The content is valuable, the content is meaningful, but how do we get them to essentially engage with this core content is something that a lot of organizations typically tend to struggle with, certifications being one of them, attending trainings being some of the other areas. So essentially, we are looking at a model which says that what is our purpose? So if our purpose is certification, the gamification and the game engine needs to run in a particular manner. If our purpose is that people need to essentially undertake a larger number of trainings or be in larger programs or in more number of programs, then the intention and the way the game engine gets designed is a little different. So essentially what one really does is one is able to look at why do we want the game to be a part of this entire setup, and we design from there. So there is at no point in time are we saying that it's one size fit all, right? Because everybody's need is different and everybody's customer, consumer need is different. As people from the human resource fraternity and as people who want to develop learning in different ways, it's important to understand that we need to be pretty sure of what our end game is. So whether it is behavioral skill, whether it is technical skill, what do we want and what is the purpose is something that essentially we need to define, right? So does it work for learning? And that is a question that has been asked and gets repeatedly asked, and that gets, depending on which end of the spectrum you are, you could get hit around the park for saying whether it works or not. So, but our experience clearly is that it works, right? You need to know how one works the game design, what are the end objectives that one needs to look at before we say that it is working or it's not working. So if we cannot link the theme to the learner's journey, it's going to be a game. So it is imperative that whatever we are thinking in terms of theme, you have to start thinking about your customer and saying what sort of a journey will excite the individual or the group of individuals that we are talking about. It cannot be something that you have thought about in isolation. It needs to be something that is slightly more consultative to understand the mind space of your learner. There must be a significantly planned reward schedule and competition based on desired behavior, which basically means that as people move into the game, they need to be rewarded for the right sort of behavior. There needs to be a baseline competition to say it's not in isolation. You are in a social space, and it is the social space that is going to define how you are going to move forward. So today I am ahead, tomorrow I am behind. It allows me to essentially work beyond that just simple space. A steady channel of feedback for different participants, for the way you as an administrator or you as a developer look at the game design is something that needs to be looked at. The social connect of games actually remains one of the most important parts of learning, right? How do we ensure that there is a socialization of the gamification? For want of a better word, what that means is that I need to be part of the ecosystem and I cannot be in isolation trying to play this game. It's not a video game. I mean, to make that distinction, even video games today are social, but this needs to be significantly more dynamic. Essentially meaning that there are spaces for conversation, there are spaces for people to ask questions, there are spaces for people to say, I have built a certain subject matter expertise and I can share it with you and you're able to gamify all these scenarios. So to give you an idea, essentially, if you say that your gamification is only driven by badges and honors and reward points, after a point in time, it ceases to be of significant merit, primarily because the whole story gets significantly repetitive. It's the same game dynamics that are constantly playing out versus having a social connect into saying that you are at a particular layer, you're a particular level of the game board, but you can still reach much higher basis your social recognition and your social rating and your social ability to influence the game board is a big difference as we see it in terms of creating the relevant learning. So, you know, playing games versus gamification, like I talked about a little earlier, there is a very fine line, and that line essentially is what determines the usefulness and the game's outcomes that we need to define. So what we mean by that is, games are important, but games tend to have a relatively limited shelf life and need to be contextualized very immediately. So if you look at any of the small activities, small icebreakers, stuff that a facilitator would tend to do as part of any larger program, its contextualization needs to be in the moment, then and there. It's very difficult to capture contextualization later. However, in the case of gamification, once we have a larger outcome defined, we are able to determine how we want to draw out this journey, right? So we are essentially saying that the gamification is a larger footprint. Gamification has ramifications across a much larger spectrum as opposed to a very small spectrum. So it is important. Game is important. Gamification is important. It really is about what we are trying to achieve at that point in time. The ability to drive it as learning links during the game, right? So when we are on a game board, when we are in a gamification engine-driven platform, how do we create learning as part of the experience? It's not just the game. It is very, very critical that the learning component comes as part of the gameplay itself that allows us to expand what people know of themselves and where they possibly want to go. The importance of post-game conversations, again, leading to the social aspect, saying that, you know, there is a particular quiz in which somebody did well. There is a particular quiz that somebody didn't do well in. There is an assessment that somebody is not able to clear and move forward into the game board. How does the gamification engine curate this? How does the gamification engine allow people to exchange views and ideas? So it's very important as to what is the outcome. We will stress a lot on saying, what do we want to achieve at a uber outcome level? Our uber level of the outcome is this. And these are all the steps that we will build in the process. So the reward, which remains a very, very important aspect of gamification, you know, so you ask a badminton player or a tennis player or any of the sports players, why do they play? Finally, it's about, I want to be world number one, I want to be world number two, or I want to win 12 tournaments in entire calendar year. There are various reward schematics, but in terms of gamification, we need to be very clear that the reward is clearly linked to the desired behavior. To give you an example from one of my previous slides, if consumption of content is a desired behavior, we reward consumption of content. If consumption of content and certification is a desired behavior, the way we choose to reward each are something that are part of the game mechanics. We need to say that certification holds a slightly higher value, maybe consumption of content holds a slightly lower value, and whatever else we have in between. So it is critical that we identify what is the outcome and the desired behavior and run our reward schematic accordingly. And when I say behavior, the behavior is essentially that the outcome that we seek. It might be a behavioral learning aspect, it might be a technical learning aspect. It really does not significantly matter in that sense. Right. So I'm going to hand it over to Renu to look at one of the case studies we had developed after working on a particular project very closely. Renu, it's back to you.
Thanks, Tamal, and thanks everyone for your attention so far. So let me walk you through the Hack to the Future project that we actually did for one of our clients last year. Now, Hack to the Future was a three-month game board design that was created to serve two purposes. One was to design an engaging learning experience around the development of two competencies that were particularly vital for a particular client team. The second intention of the game board design, of the gamification process, was to explore the possibilities of adding digital elements and platforms to learning design. Now, I'm hoping as I go through this and actually be able to answer some of the questions from the board that we're seeing here. And thank you so much, guys, for all of your questions. Hopefully, with this case study, we'll be able to take care of your doubts for you to some degree. Now, it all began with the learning intention. And the learning intention was the development of these two competencies. One was team output, and the second was feedback. Not that these competencies are particularly new to anyone who is listening to, who's watching this webinar right now. But having said that, we don't really take anything for granted when it comes to learning design, when it comes to gamification. The concepts of these competencies can be fluid, across teams, across levels, and that's something that you need to be cognizant of at the very start of the gamification process. So what we did was we split each competency into five levels of demonstration. We split them from level one to level five, with level five being the state of excellence in that particular competency. What that does, for example, with the feedback, you have level one to level five. So level five is when somebody is able to, for example, solicit and provide feedback at a particular level of openness of listening and openness of conversation, right? And obviously the definition for this is more detailed. What that allows the learning provider to do is recognize when these behaviors are being displayed or not and allowed to put a metric to it. This allows for us to be able to track development from day one, whether it's a week's game board, whether it's a three-month game board, whether it's even a year's worth, year-long game board. Whatever it is, you're able to track development of people when you actually put it down in words and you're able to recognize the behaviors that eventually demonstrate that particular competency. It's a not painstaking process, but it's an imperative process and it does take out some time. The people who are going to eventually go through your game board need to be analyzed, if that's not a better word. The idea is that your game board needs to keep the user in mind. Now, this was a group of homogenous people, and they were all from the same function in the organization. However, they did not work together. They did not work on the same clients or the same project. They were ICs of sorts, individual contributors, but a couple of them did get into pseudo-managerial roles. So the idea is that we did spend some time getting to know the audience, paying attention to, certain cultural references that would make a lot of sense for them, and that accordingly went into the game board design. The construct of the game board began with an actual game board. There was a start point, there was an end point, there was a physical game board. It was a race of sorts where you actually had different pathways that each team could take. And the way to go through those paths was to demonstrate the skills that were being requested for by the organization. The level of demonstration when it came to team output or feedback determined how the team was going to move across the game board. The definition of the competency allows for you to decide the dynamics of the game board. what we started off with were actual live sessions, face-to-face sessions. So we met with the participants, we met with the teams once every 2 weeks, holding completely different game-based learning experiences for them every fortnight. Basis their behavior and output of those live sessions, they would get awards and rewards and points that were being accrued on a weekly basis. And this would basically see whether or track whether they were moving across the game board or not. To supplement the face-to-face sessions, because we didn't really want to lose touch with the audience, we also held online sessions. Now, these online sessions were a variety of sessions, whether it was running a tweet chat, whether it was about boosting your clout, whether it was even taking a short survey. The idea is that when you go online, the possibilities for engagement are endless. And this is something that we incorporated into this game board in order to be able to track that behavior. And whatever behavior that we were tracking, whatever tasks that we gave them, we were able to eventually link it to the competencies and how being excellent at a particular competency would eventually help them with that task, right? Now, this allowed us to do the next piece, which was data collection. We'll give you our learnings from what we picked up in the sense that you just mindlessly go around collecting data, but there is a point where you draw the line and saying that, okay, fine, beyond this, I don't really want to burden my system, nor do I want to burden the game board. While everything seems exciting, I need to draw a line. The data that we collected were actual behavior trackers. We collected data on emotion tracking by using certain software called Emotient, and there's loads basically available in the world right now. We were able to even track the social element, the social conversations that people were having amongst the teams, not only between the teams, but also on the World Wide Web. We were able to basically collect a large amount of data points using this game board. And through that, track the behavioral progress from day one to day 90. Now, the idea is this. Not everything was roses. Not everything was all the way going up. We have to, of course, be very mindful of the game design process, of the gamification process as it's going through. We would tweak the game board if necessary to ensure that we were doing the best that we could in order to help the people who are playing the game to display those competencies to the best of their ability. Right, the media that we used, I'm just going to go back here, and this is what we did. It's a lot to take in. It was a very, very complex game board, if that's the right word to use here. We used social media, like I said before. We used WhatsApp. We used QR codes. We used Fitbit. We used Emotient. We used NFC tags for cloud for content consumption tracking. We used Cloud. We used DubSmash. We used WhatsApp. We even used one of our behavior measurement platforms called Enhance. We use that to do some of the behavior tracking during the 3 month period. We also went back to some typical tools that are used in the HR space. We used DISC assessment. We used the AGES model. All of this were used to actually generate the data that we eventually used to do the output. So while engaging in the learning over 3 months was part one of the intention, all of the data that we created over 3 months, we then correlated to ask these certain questions that are there certain things, elements, platforms, media that actually help learners learn better? Did certain social interactions or the more vocal people in the group, do they display certain behaviors that are more conducive to the competency that we're trying to develop? Basis all of these data correlations, we were able to then address our bigger picture, which was recommend certain changes and edits to the learning design. And that's really what this game board was. It's again, very large, very complex game board. But what it helped us do beyond helping in engaging the learners in a very, very competitive, yes, and also very interactive, very involved, and very evolved learning journey over those 3 months. Do we be able to add value to the learning and development design philosophy of an organization? That's really, that's the wonderful big picture that we had for this project. So our learning from this case study, we asked ourselves the question, is there a right way to do gamification? And no, there is no right way to do gamification. However, there are wrong ways to do this. Okay, and the wrong ways, or rather the things that really got in the way of it being gamification and becoming playing games, when it becomes, you know, too competitive and all of that, basically the intention is lost. One of those things was not having an end game in sight. So 3 months is a fairly long time to engage any number of people, whether it's a small group of, say, 10 or a large group of, say, 400. 3 months is a long time. And as game board designers, as gamification process designers, learning designers, sometimes we can lose sight of the end game that we're looking for, of the development, of the learning design principles that we're trying to adapt. It's entirely possible for us to, you know, lose track of that and get stuck in gamification elements like points and leaderboards and boss fights and badges and all of that. So all of those can sometimes get in the way if we lose sight of the end game. So have your end game in mind, and believe me, you will create a fantastic game board. Playing a game for game's sake. So we'll, again, I just want to be really honest and transparent about the things that we even got wrong during that case study. So I mentioned that we had Fitbit, and for some reason, Fitbit became a competitive space in terms of, you know, how many steps you're taking and how many cloud points you're getting based on the Fitbit post that you're putting out there. It became pointless, to be honest, and it took time and energy, not only for the participants, but for us to also track that kind of movement. You know, our technical team and our data analytics team spent, you know, days trying to figure out the Fitbit data, and eventually that's something that just doesn't work. So why get into all of that if it really doesn't make sense for your game? The competitive element of this exercise took a whole new level, you know, by around the third week of the assignment, and that's when we realized that it was too competitive. The entire space of team output has to do with collaboration, and that was completely, you know, off the mark at the third week. We actually had to step in. Like I said, we have to be agile when it comes to gamification. We had to stop the process. We did an intervention with the teams and kind of reminded them of the intention. It became cutthroat competition, where it stopped becoming about playing a game for learning. It became about playing a game to win, and the learning had nothing, no consequence to anything. And it became about playing a game so much that I'm willing to hurt somebody else who's on another team. And that's when we really, we need to draw the line at how competitive we make this too. Sometimes rewards may not be lucrative enough. So for example, you know, even something as, you know, simple as free money, like Paytm, being a reward mechanism in, you know, for a game board, we may think as designers that it's a great idea. Everyone wants free money. But if you don't analyze your audience well enough, you'll end up offering something that they truly do not care about. And it just becomes something that you spend money on, and it becomes something that absolutely adds no value to, it doesn't really add too much value to the gamification process. Right. So a few words from our experience before I hand it over to Tamal to close out with, you know, with the webinar. Plan well, very well, like to a ridiculous level of granularity in your planning, because what it does is it allows for you to be in complete control of your gamification process. Plus, if you need to change your game board at some point in time in the future, you're able to without upsetting the apple cart too much. So be in charge of your game board by planning very well. So knowing your intent, understanding your audience is just, you know, stepping stones to that planning process. Draw the line between playing games and gamification for learning. Going back to a few points that Tamal mentioned earlier about, you know, the conversations during the game, conversations post the game, prepping the audience before the game board even begins. These are imperative if you want to make sure that whatever exercise you're putting your people through, there is a connection, a learning connection. And of course, whatever, you know, experiential elements that you put into your game, they have to meet with part one, which is knowing your intention. If they don't, then you're playing a game for the sake of playing games. Make it worth their while. I'm coming back, just beating myself a little bit in that we, with all of the best intentions as learning and learning designers and content developers, we really, you know, have the best intent. However, sometimes we can get it wrong. And keeping an eye on our participants is something that we need to keep keep in mind it's them that we're doing this for, we're not doing it for us. And when that happens, your entire game design process kind of it really goes to that next level. And that's a few words of experience from us. What I'll do now is we're kind of to the end of our presentation here, and from that perspective, thank you so much for listening in, and I can see loads of questions popping up on the Q&A forum. So Shweta, how do you want to run this?
So as you already said, there's so many questions popping up, so I'll just take up a question, and you or Tamal can decide who wants to answer that.
Sounds good.
Sure.
Perfect. So shall I begin with the question and answers?
Shoot.
Great. So so the first question is coming from Prashant. So he says that the core to gamification is fun along with competition, but how to balance out both while designing any gamification framework?
Right. So I think, Tushar, the answer really to that is the elements of fun need to lead to people wanting to do more of what the end intent is really all about. So the balance really lies between saying that is an individual here only for fun? Because if he's here only for fun, then he's not going to move ahead. Is he here? So what is the intent? So if I say my end intent is that I would like a particular end result, a particular behavior to be achieved, and in achieving that, there is so much of fun that I can provide, but there is so much that I need to design by way of engine that a guy doesn't get attracted only to the fun. So when you design the game engine, you design it in such a fashion that while the fun gets you some reward and some recognition, the larger reward and recognition and the nudges are to get to the core of what you require. So it could be content consumption, it could be attendance, it could be mandatory compliance, whatever those parts be, right? So it's important to say that when I'm looking at the design, my end intention, if my end intention is fun, then there should only be fun on the board. But if my end intention is to say there is a specific learning outcome, there is a specific organizational outcome I would like to achieve from here, then the skew of the game board definitely needs to be in that direction. Back to you, Shweta. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Tamal, for answering that. And we have just received a question from Aleem Ran, and it is directed towards you. He says, "Hello, Tamal, I have a question. What should I keep in mind when gamifying someone for an audience which is not fixed in number? For example, suppose I am designing a gamification for new joinees in a company, and the new joinees keep coming every month."
All right, Ali, thanks very much. That is a question of significant merit, and it is also a question of significant challenge, because you are looking at an asynchronous timing on any kind of gamification board or game engine that you want. That having been said, if you look at the new joinee induction, your primary question is going to be that there is going to be some form of people joining at a particular point in time at a particular rate, right? So you design your journey in such a fashion that people are able to catch up at different points in time. So that is to say that suppose a person has joined the company today and a person has joined the company 20 days from now, all the people who have joined in today are running in a particular batch, for want of a better word, and people who have joined from day 20 to say day 40 or day 50, however you have, are running in a particular batch, and you are able to populate even inter-batch scores. Finally, you're able to run the game board and on an inter-batch basis. So what that does is, it doesn't matter at which point in time the individual comes into the game board, as long as you are able to essentially manage a baseline administration of the entire process. A flip side could be, you don't care, you say, my design is so robust that as people join, I take them through the entire process, and wherever they are, we will look at how this entire engine is going to run. So both are possible, but yes, I think this is something that needs a significant investment of time in understanding what is the outcome that you desire. Thank you very much for that question.
thank you so much, Tamal, for answering that. So moving on, next we have a question from Tanu Mehta. She wants to know, are there any statistics or cases that can be shared with management to prove the value gamification brings, and is it an investable idea?
I think, Tanu, there is enough and more out there today. We would be happy to share statistics and cases with you without a problem. That gamification certainly is a way forward, especially more millennial and younger audiences. There is enough to prove that gamification is an investable idea. Now, I will ask, or a more pertinent fact is going to be, one must be really clear, gamification for gamification's sake is not going to work. Right? Just because gamification is either cool or gamification creates a slightly larger engagement, it does not make it investable. If you are not very sure of what is the end, right, then you are not really going to be able to get that desired output, which I see as linked to your other question, which is how do we evaluate effectiveness of gamified training, right? It has to be as to what is our end outcome. So then you, when you know that your end outcome is, if your end outcome is effectiveness, your game board design essentially runs towards saying, I'm seeking effectiveness, I'm not necessarily seeking attendance. These are two different things, right? So that distinction sort of needs to be made. Thank you for your question.
Thank you, Tamal, for answering that. So we have two questions which are quite similar in nature. So I'm going to take both of them one by one. First is from Kamal, and he says, does one need to keep in mind the different generation of employee groups while using gamification? And a similar in nature question is coming from Garima. She asks, do you think gamification works for all sets of audience, or the senior level audience might not have the time or patience to go through a game and would want to go through the concept instantly?
Thank you for the question again. I'll answer Garima's question first, which is around, say, senior level audiences, right? The whole purpose of gamification is to provide a more immersive experience, so that people are desirous of continuously moving from one place to the other and without being constantly told what to do. So I don't think it matters whether it is the audience is junior or senior, but the design elements for a senior audience are going to be significantly different from the design elements of a junior audience, right? One needs to say that, hey, there is a certain way in which they like to see things, or there is a certain depth of approach that they like to see, and we need to build that into the mechanics and the engine. And to look at Kamal's question, I think demographics between different grades and different sections of the organizations do matter, right? But what is most imperative is you're never going to have a catch-all. You're never going to be able to say that, hey, I'm designing a game experience or a gamified environment or a gamification platform which is going to be catch-all. The gamification platform's basic fundamentals, suppose I say, to give you a simple example, we would like to see more people attending open programs, right? And when you say open programs in an organization, it could be across all levels. Now, that is the problem we want to address, and that can be addressed by gamification, which is irrespective of the grade where the person is. But if you say, I would like our leadership team to demonstrate more mentoring values, and we would like them to become better mentors and coaches, and we want to design a gamification experience around that, that is a completely different sort of a design or a completely different element. So what is it that we want to achieve is the all critical, and I think Renu has talked about it a lot. It is, we start with the end in mind, and then you roll down, not because it's just interesting in parts. And that's what we would look at. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Tamal, for answering that. So moving on to the next question, it is coming from Rini Chakrabarti. She wants to know, what are the measures to ensure that the desired behavior is retained by the participants in the long run.
Renu, would you like to take that?
Yeah, sure. So thanks so much for your question. I'll go back to what I had spoken about earlier, which was the definition of competencies to the granularity, the level of granularity where you are able to attach metrics to it. Now, the thing is this, with any gamification process, it's a journey. And it makes some sense to actually revisit after a certain amount of time because it's any behavior change takes time to develop, sure. It needs a particularly strong base to start from. So if you want to, whatever metrics that you decide at the start of your gamification process and say that gamification, that game board runs for say a month. Now after that, you touch base after say a quarter and using those same metrics, you run a short evaluation with your audience at that point in time. It would make some sense to kind of keep, like I said, there's a certain agility that's required when it comes to learning design. And if those metrics, the numbers that come up after a quarter or so, don't really meet expectations, then you need to have your bank of support content ready, or whether you need to run, say, another game board, or whether you need to actually just support in some sort of way using coaching or using mentoring or other methods like that. Tamal, anything for you?
No, I think essence is going to be that in the gamification process, measurement is anyway built in towards a particular outcome. So if we say that how do we know that the behavior change is there and sustainable, that means that outcome needs to come into your game board. You need to build the game board, you need to build the gamification engine that accounts for that outcome consistently. And only then are you going to be able to say that you are consistently measuring or consistently being able to see behavior that is in line with the desired metric that you have put in the first place, which is that the change of behavior is sustained primarily. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Tamal and Renu, for answering that. Now, moving on, we again have two questions that are similar in nature, so I'm going to take both of them one by one. So, first is coming from Rakesh Kumar. He wants to know, how much time does it take to design and implement gamification in the organization? And second is from Arushi. She says, what do you think is the approximate time in the entire process of gamification? That is from searching a vendor till the execution of the game.
So this is a contentious question, in my opinion, in the sense that it really comes back to an outcome, and it really comes back to how much of tech is going to go into this entire process. So if there is a significant amount of tech in terms of saying that the entire process will primarily be an online process where everything is going to happen, the game board is online and the multitude of processes, the entire engine is running online, that's a long-term development, anything from 4 months to 8 months. But on the shorter end of the spectrum, if you are willing to run parts of it offline and do parts of it online, it could be anything from 2 months to 4 months. But to answer both those questions, I would look at it like this, that when one is investing in game board design and gamification at any layer, the recommendation would be to think long term. The recommendation would be to say that I should be able to use this and amortize this cost over a much larger time frame and a period for it to make significant ROI to what we are doing. So if your thing is very short term, you are better off looking at a larger offline component. But if you have a significant long term view, then you certainly are better off saying that how will this system mostly run on its own, which means you're going to look at a significant footprint of somebody who has the technology expertise to do this as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Tamal, for answering that. In fact, taking cue from your answer, we had a similar question earlier, which was from Komal. So she wanted to know, does gamification learning work best for a long-term intervention or one short-term learning objective also?
So when we look at it, what is the definition of a short-term is something that would be interesting, but let me assume short-term is a month to 3 months, and long-term is anything beyond that. Gamification works at all levels. Gamification is not driven by the duration. The gamification is creating the pull irrespective of your duration. So the gamification engine, whatever you're running, even if it is for a 1 month intervention, people are invested in that because they want at that 1 month to receive reward recognition in whatever fashion at the end of that 1 month. Versus if you're running for a 3 month, your episodes might be more spaced out. What you are doing with them might be more spaced out. But fundamentally, pure play duration is not key in a gamification design. Short term, long term are all driven by what are the sort of outcomes that one looks at. So if my short term outcome is compliance and attendance, the direction of my gamification would go there. If my long-term requirement is improved behavioral economics, which is that the behavior graph that I would like to see is that much better, which is impacting business outcomes, I would build for the shorter periods, I would build it in the attendance compliance mode, and for the longer periods, we would build it into the behavioral economics mode. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Tamal, for taking that question. So the next one is coming from Prakriti Panwar. She wants to know, is this web-based? Do you have an app too for easy access through the smartphones? And also, what are the best reward ideas that have attracted participants to learn and enjoy the rewards too?
So the gamification engine could be multi-platform. The gamification engine could be web-based. The gamification engine could be app-based. We are currently designing a multimodal asynchronous platform, which is accessible almost any device, right? From a reward standpoint, you know, what people really seek are two kinds of rewards. Social recognition, very, very important, often underrated. And social recognition comes in many forms, which should come into the design. That is one. And in terms of the fact that whatever gamification engine you run and whatever game-based stuff you do, there must be some form of a tangible reward in the space that it is running. So the tangibility is, I think, a function of what the organization wants to afford. And that comes from the demographics of different people. So from small stuff to big stuff, that part comes as a function of what the organization wants to sort of spend on the reward mechanism. But there needs to be a real world correlation to the reward. That is something we have seen, and we see imperative to keep people continued on the platform. Thank you.
Thank you, Tamal. So we again have two questions that are quite similar in context. So I would like to take both of them together. First is coming from Shiv Kumaram. So he says, can gamification replace classroom training? And what is the typical cost for building a gamification module for developing a specific competency? And second question is from Meenakshi. So she says, how does the budget for gamification goes like? It depends on what all factors.
Okay. Thank you very much for the question. So my first answer is around, is gamification going to replace classroom training? Unless we end up being a significantly super intelligent race, the answer to that is no. However, classroom training could be a part of gamification. Classroom training could be a subset of your overall gamification engine and your overall gamification board. You don't really need to look at it as something that is separate from a gamification process, gamification layer, game board engine. That is one. The second question is around costs, and the second creating it for one competency, one game at two different. I'll look at costs, overall costs as one aspect, and I will look at single competency based costs as a separate aspect. The way a game board gets amortized is long term thought into what sort of outcomes do you want. So if you are going in for a gamification engine, and suppose I say you're looking at it for first time managers, I'm just going to take a case that we are sort of working with. First time managers, then your engine must be such that maybe you are having 1,000 first time managers come into your system, but your engine should be good enough to say that this is going to run for 5 years from now, and I'm going to amortize my long term costs over the long term. That has to be the model. If you say, I'm just developing it for 1,000 people, it ends up being too expensive. That's point number one. If you're going to do it for a single competency, you might really want to evaluate between offline and online, meaning tech and no tech. But if you're going to say, I'm taking single competency, something that we are working on, we are taking organization values globally, and we would like a gamified environment around that, then you are talking about saying, you know what, it's going to go through all sets of employees, and that's something that we are happy to invest in on at a game board level. So if it is short, episodic, maybe a more offline model, which is tends to be cheaper, versus a significantly long-term view, which tends to be more investment in technology, and as a consequence, more expensive. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Tamal. So moving on to the next question, it is coming from Kapil Tomar. So his question is on limitation of gamification. So he says, are there any limitations that a gamification program has, like the type of content which are most suited for gamification and some which are not?
Okay. So I think I like this question enormously. Thank you, Kapil. Gamification is not the solution to all woes of either the HR fraternity or the learning fraternity. It can deliver only so much. Is some kind of content? Content is not your main play. Almost engines will support any kind of content. Content is really not. What you really need to be sure of is, have we got our desired end result right? That's one. And are we mapping out our consumer behavior in line with what is our audience? If you have not mapped your consumer behavior right, you're really not going to get relevant results. Whether you gamify, you make it exciting, you build more games, not going to really work. But what is key is, what is my consumer behavior? Have I mapped my consumer behavior to what I really want? And on that basis, you run your gamification engine, much larger success. If you only run it on saying, hey, I'm just going to create a gamified environment, and people will obviously come there, your gamification is likely to fail. Right? So, yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Tamal. So we just have space for one last question, and I'm going to take a question coming from Prasanna. So he's asking, any example of gamification being used for training on company values? How to balance the fun versus sensitivities of company values?
Thank you, Prasanna. It's our since it is our ongoing and present project, right? The sensitivity around company values comes from the context that the company provides in order to understand how these contexts will get built into the game or into the game board or into the gamification process. So it is certainly not about just the fun, and I talked about it earlier to a question, I think, which came earlier, which primarily is that the fun is of a certain layer in the game board. How that translates from being allowing people to move from fun to accessing or demonstrating more relevant aspects are things that the game board and the gamification layer helps. So the fun typically would have a smaller component in its weightage in the entire gamified environment, versus the context. So values gamification is something that we as an organization very strongly believe in, and we would we think that it is an area that is very relevant in terms of how it can be gamified. Thank you, but yes, it can be done.
Thank you so much, Tamal, for answering that. And with this question and answer session, we are going to wrap up today's webinar. Once again, we thank today's webinar partner, Change Inc. Also, a big thanks to our speakers, Tamal Bhatia and Renu Kotian, for this webinar and the amazing insights that they have shared with us today. And I would like to thank everybody in the webinar audience for participating in today's presentation. We will come back to you with many more. We will be uploading the webcast on People Matters website shortly, so please stay tuned. This concludes today's webcast. Thank you all and have a great day ahead.